dating am live.
Way to start.
Hello. Well, we're finally here. I'd like to say I was all prepared and got here an hour early. And
which is very normal Kellyanne behavior, actually.
Yeah, I would normally be here early. But anyhow, the Don Valley did not allow. So it's okay, as I just blow the wind out of my hair now. And well, let's take a sip, because we're here with...
Yay!
Jennifer Trask.
Hi.
Is she beautiful or not? My mindset coach. Cheers.
Cheers.
Here's to our, 20 plus years in business?
Of experience together, yes.
Yes. And we've been working together for... 10? Years?
No, not 10.
9?
Something.
I don't remember. Say 9 years. I think since 2010. Eight years. It's 2018.
8 years.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. We'll go with that.
Okay, 8 years. We've been working
it all
together.
Meshes in between, so you can't.
It does. And we've done intensive work, because not only did I hire her as my mindset coach back in the day.
Well, started as your marketing coach.
Oh.
Started marketing.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It wasn't mindset first. Oh. That okay. happens after when you think marketing is the problem.
Yeah. And then you realize,
it's not the problem.
It's not your marketing.
Yeah.
It's your mind.
Yeah.
And and if you don't straighten out your mind, your marketing will not fly.
No.
So I met Jennifer back in the day. Oh, maybe I should introduce myself first.
Yeah. For those who don't know.
For yes. those who don't know. Okay, let's start, let's get the formalities out of the way. I'm Kellyanne Pai Bechara, and I am a visual artist and blogger, a photographer, Newfoundland enthusiast, hiker, jack of all trades,
Jill of all trades.
Jill of all trades. Yeah. And I have been doing visual art since 1990. And over the years, I have changed over to, I've broadened my scope.
Yeah.
From not only just the artwork, but into other things to keep it interesting for myself.
Yep.
And hopefully others. That's always a bonus. Mm-hmm. And in 2010, I met Jennifer. I will tell you the story about how we met.
Good story.
It is a good story.
It's actually, it's a really good story.
Yeah. And it's kind of neat when things line up.
Yeah.
And
it's a good story of how how the universe brings you what you need all the time.
Which Jennifer taught me. And so did Besh.
Yeah. Besh is here too.
Yeah,
tell
right.
me who Besh is.
I will. So in the background, in behind here, which is where he sometimes likes to be, as opposed to in front of the camera. He actually does in front of the camera as well. But when it comes to the art things that we do, he is definitely my muse. And he has been one of my biggest supporters all the way along. And he also does his own talks as well. It's called My Besh Guess. You can check him out on the YouTube. And he's here today, and he does the technical things. He gets us set up with the mics and all that stuff.
It's also your husband.
Oh, yeah, and my husband. Your husband. Probably number one. He's my husband.
First and foremost.
Yeah, and he helps us out with all this stuff, and he gets me around to where I need to be, and he's my travel partner, hence being in Toronto. Ta-da! On this beautiful day. CN Tower is just right there.
Just right there.
Yeah, just right there. Is it really?
Yes, it's okay. That's the right way.
And I'm directionally challenged, which is why I decided to get into art and not map making.
Yeah.
And so Besh is back there, and this is Jennifer Trask, mindset coach, and one of my BFFs.
Yeah.
Why don't you tell them what a mindset coach even is? Some people don't even know. I didn't know really until I met you.
No.
So
true.
You tell them what you do and why this matters to the conversation.
So, I am a mindset coach for entrepreneurs, and in the work that I do, it's actually not complex. It's actually quite simple. People overcomplicate things, I think, which I have done myself.
Which is where you come into play.
Yeah, yeah. So, basically, I work with entrepreneurs who want to grow their businesses and be of service and really allow themselves to be the best version of themselves. And oftentimes, the way that, so when I come in, it's because people have a lot of belief systems and stories and conflicts, internal conflicts that stop them from being that best version of themselves. And we live in a society where people feel a lot of expectations from others, from the people who love them, from the society that they're in, and oftentimes what we want is in conflict of that. So we have to be brave and courageous to take steps beyond that and be the version of ourselves that we know that we are, even though we may have people or things in our way that are pulling us in other directions. And I think that anyone who's ever gone against the grain knows exactly what I'm talking about. And also sometimes when you're en route to what you want, you don't even know that you have things that are blocking you. And so my job is to come in and discover where the person wants to go, where they are, and close the gap.
That's where you've really helped me a poop ton.
Yeah.
A lot.
Yeah, and that's, I think, what we're going to discuss today. A lot of the, and that's where the value comes for those watching, because you can learn so much from people who've walked their path and notice if that happened. Because 9.999 times out of 10, if it's happening for you, it's happening for like 10 million people around you. You know, like,
You're not the only one.
No
matter what your situation is, you're probably not the only one.
And it's funny because I have clients who will be on calls and they'll say, oh my God, I must be your hardest client, this, that. And I'm like, No, it's not just
you. I've seen you before.
Yeah. And so, or that version. And I think what the beauty of that is that we're not alone.
Yeah.
We're not alone. And
I find you explain that, well, to me, the client, a lot, which made me feel like I wasn't the only one.
Yeah, because especially when you're an entrepreneur who's working from home, it's very easy to feel isolated. And when you feel alone and isolated, you almost feel like stupid that you have these beliefs, or stupid that you can't, like, why can't I get past this? But there's nothing wrong with you. It's actually quite normal.
Yeah.
And if you don't know what you don't know, you shouldn't get mad at yourself for not knowing something. You don't know it yet.
Right.
And so your job is to more get curious about how to move beyond it instead of being angry that you're there.
You definitely helped me with my self-employment anger.
I was angry. Tell us why you are angry, Kelly.
Well, Jennifer.
Self-employment is friggin' hard.
It is hard.
It's hard.
Yeah.
Like, I'd like to put the fluffy veil on it, but it's effing hard.
Yeah, it is hard.
Like,
it's not an easier choice all the time.
It's so much work.
Yeah.
So much work. So, I mean, I'm an artist, so I'd like, you know, people say to me, oh, do you just paint all day long and in your studio? And I'm like, oh, honey, no.
Yeah.
Wouldn't
no.
that be nice?
Yeah.
And everything just settles itself.
That's right. Just flies out my studio doors. I just finish a painting, just disappears. Everything just happens miraculously.
No.
It's hard. You have to be, you're the marketer, you're the salesperson.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm the artist, just you know, for number one.
Yeah.
What else do you do? You do bookkeeping.
Yeah.
you know, totally in alignment with the arts. It's not.
You do everything. You have, until you can source out,
yes.
which is the goal.
Yes.
Because the ultimate goal, I think, of entrepreneurship is get yourself out of the stuff you don't want to be doing.
That's not your talent.
Out of the trenches. Well, not out of the trenches. Completely out of the trenches of the tasks that are not relevant to you.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
so, but like, I don't want to be out of the trenches. To me, in the trenches is working with clients. That's what I do.
Oh, I feel like working in the trenches is like the accounting.
Oh, well.
The cruddy, crappy part of self-employment that has to be done no matter what.
Well, yes, but some people like that, so we'll give
that. Whoa, really?
Okay, not
the
me.
Accountants like it.
Bookkeepers like it. That's their
But I
jazz.
Mean, you're doing all those things.
Sure.
As a self-employed
yeah, yeah,
person.
Yeah. No, that's so our definition of in the trenches is a little different.
Yeah, right.
But that's all right.
Yeah. So whatever in the trenches is for you, Jennifer helps us out of the trenches. So we met. So let's talk about how we met.
Oh, yeah.
So that is
fun
what Jennifer
story.
Does, by the way.
Yes, that is what I do.
She's really good at it.
I am really good at it.
You are really good at
yeah,
it.
Yeah, I am.
And I knew her
it
from
took
the
me
beginning.
A while to figure that out.
I think I told you enough.
You
too,
do.
In the beginning. She just started talking about mindset stuff, and I'm like, holy crap. Does everybody know this?
No.
Turns out, no. Which is why we need you. I didn't know
that's
it
right.
either. And I'm like, she has not the fountain of youth, but the she's got like the holy grail of business in her. So I was like, I need that. So how we met, Besh and I moved back to Newfoundland in 2009, and then sort of moving the business from, we were in Stainer, Ontario, and so I had set up my business there, and then of course moving a business is always interesting, but it's so much easier these days due to online technology and all that stuff that it wasn't as hard as it would have been back in the day. So we moved back, and so of course we're getting settled in, and we're spending lots of time with our family and that type of stuff, and so Besh goes on the hunt for friends, and he's like, I want people of like-mindedness, and Besh is into some stuff that's different than what I used to be into, but now I'm into it, and so he likes to meet people who are forward thinkers,
highly conscious.
Besh likes to jump in the deep end without
universe talk,
and I'm like, sounds poopy fruity, but there was good stuff in it as we went along. So he says to me one day, he's like, Pi, we've been here a year, and I haven't really met anybody who I'm really clicking with, who's into like the stuff I'm into. And so, of course, in my quick wit, I turn around and I go, well, remember the law of attraction? Why don't you just put it out there and see what happens? And he's like, oh, that's a good idea.
Magic.
Right? Touché. And so he's like, okay, what would it feel like to, you know, have, you know, some good buddies who are like right into what I'm into, and put it out there? And I'm like, yeah, all right, let's see how this flies. And within 48 hours, did you say? We go to a housewarming party.
But tell them how you get to the housewarming party.
Oh, that's true too. Because we were through the Kathy Link?
Yeah.
Okay, so we're downtown and we're on Water Street and we're at Blue on Water and sunny.
The restaurant
and gorgeous.
In St. John's, Newfoundland.
Oh my God, Google there. Especially on a sunny day.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Big doors are open and it's gorgeous.
Yeah.
You know those 2 days?
Those 2 days of summer in Newfoundland.
They're really fun.
Yeah.
And so we're sitting there, we're having a drink, and next thing along comes these bright blue eyes, and I'm like, oh my God, that's Kathy Trask, Jennifer's sister, who I hadn't even thought of Jennifer at this point in time.
Right.
And so we're like, oh my God, and we have a grand old chat.
You know them because you're cousins.
Yes. We're
third
cousins. We Googled it the other night. I think we figured
just
it out.
Sure.
Her mom and my mom are cousins.
That's right.
Perfect. So I think that made us third cousins. So cheers to third cousins.
Third cousins.
Like I didn't have enough first cousins to cover it. I have 47 first cousins. Just so you know.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So they're downtown, and they run into my sister.
Yeah.
Kathy.
And so we have a great chat, and Kathy.
We thought we got disconnected for a minute.
No. Okay.
Touching the screen.
In a juice box.
In a juice box.
You should take pictures with your camera.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So we have a great old chat with Kathy, and she's just like a breath of fresh air, and she's got the same sparkly blue eyes. Check them out.
Just like
that. So we have a great chat, and she's like, oh, we just moved back too, and you know, we're
back,
having
yeah.
a housewarming party.
Yeah.
Why don't you guys come? And I was like, oh, okay, yeah, right. I remember the Trasks I did my fine arts degree at Grenfell College, which is the extension of Memorial University of Newfoundland. It's a long name.
Yes, it is.
And I did it in Corner Brook, which is on the west coast of Newfoundland. We live on the east coast of Newfoundland. So I went to the west coast, did my fine arts degree for 4 years, and my aunt and uncle lived out there. So every Sunday I would go over there for dinner, or if I was feeling homesick, I'd just go sleep at their house and they made me feel better. And then some Sundays we would go to the Trask's house, which was my Aunt Barb's cousin.
Yeah.
Who is Jennifer's mom.
Yeah.
Follow that.
I sound like my mom. And so back in the day, so say it's 1990, and we go
yeah,
over
that's
for
right.
dinner to Jennifer's house, which is her parents' house. Mm-hmm. So we go over to their parents' house, and Jennifer is
nine.
And I'm 19.
19.
So no connect. Jennifer's just this little girl running around, and I'm like,
as I was
with the adults.
What about grade at nine? Grade four, grade three or four or something?
9 years old.
Something like that.
Grade four.
Okay,
grade
four.
Oh, yeah, grade four. And I'm in first year university.
First year university.
So you see the no connect then. So I don't even really pay attention to her. You know, she's cute enough. But off we go. And then, so over the 4 years, I see the Trasks on and off. And off I go and move across Canada. And
do your thing.
Goes on. And, so then we meet Kathy down on Water Street.
Yeah, she's 5 years older than me, so that's an closer age gap.
It is closer.
Yeah.
Now, meanwhile, I didn't even really connect with Kathy back in the day either.
Right, yeah.
But Jason, I remember more than anything. Jason
yeah.
is Jennifer's brother.
My eldest.
Who's also
yeah.
a wicked business guy.
Yeah.
And nice guy.
Oh, yeah.
So, all this time passes. Next thing, it's 2010.
Sure.
Yeah. And Vesh puts it out to the universe that he would like to meet more fun, like-minded, happy people that are into what he's into. We get invited to the house party. So we go to the party the next day, I think. Maybe after we
came. Well, that would have been 48 hours.
Yeah, right. Sorry. So we go to Kathy's housewarming party and chit-chat. Next thing, Vesh meets
So
Jennifer.
I sit at the island where the food is. And there's this guy there
who's also sitting at the
island. Who's also sitting at the island where the food is. And we just start chatting. And what you need to know is, first of all, I didn't know who he was. Second of all, I didn't actually really know who Kellyanne was because we didn't grow up in the same place. And she was like a third cousin. So
yeah, we didn't see each other.
We didn't really, didn't see each other. I didn't make the connect.
And I don't even think you knew Kathy had met
No, that's right.
The party was the first time.
Right, so then when Vesh said, his name is Brent, but we call him Vesh. When Vesh said that he was married to Kellyanne, then I sort of was like, Kellyanne Pye, I think we're related. How do you know everybody? And then we made the connection.
Yeah, right.
And I became friends with Vesh first.
Yeah. And so we leave the party, and he's like, oh my God, that Jennifer Trask, she's just the bomb, and you should hear her, and we were talking about this and that,
because I was in business by then.
Yeah, and you were like really
into this stuff.
Yeah.
And
so is he.
And practicing, and I was also working with coaches and helping them build their business, which is what Vesh wanted to be a speaker.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah,
so it
right.
all connected.
It was all happening. Oh, right.
Yes. Because we need more messengers.
We need more messengers.
Jennifer often freaks Vesh out with her belief in him. Oh, actually, and me. Every now and then she says something and I'm like, You're right, but it's frightening.
Yeah.
So then you and Besh hung out a bit.
We did.
And I was doing a painting in the front lobby of, in the main lobby of the Delta Hotel.
Yes. Oh, this beautiful print. If you've not seen this painting, it's extraordinary.
It's called Shot from a Cannon.
Night and day. Back, it's, and it's huge. Its original is huge.
Yeah. 14 and a half feet by 4 feet, and it's one of my cutouts, so it's sculptural. It's on plywood. It's the narrows. And it was massive. So I'm doing it in public. The painting.
Yeah.
And
yep.
So do the painting, and Jennifer is coming to see Besh because Besh is there with me, like he always is when
yes.
I paint in public, and
yes.
He's actually serving coffee and chatting with everybody who comes up so that I can paint, more. And I mean, I still chat a bit, but he did the majority of the chatting. So then Jennifer shows up to see Besh. And it's like, oh, little Jennifer Trask. Oh my God, how strange. All of a sudden, we're the same age. So before we were 9 and 19, and
yeah.
Then we were, you were 30?
So 20, 10,
yeah,
30. 30.
30 and 40.
30
and 40, which is like the same age, basically.
Yeah,
once you're the same height, you're practically the
same age. Even though you're still taller than me.
Oh, that's true.
Yeah,
that's because I'm a little older.
Just a little bit. Yeah.
And
yes.
then we were kind of face to face, and we just had a little chat, and I was like, she's interesting. Kind of seeing what
she's
interested in her. And at first I did think like maybe you were too university, like Besh.
Oh right, yeah.
But then you were like,
yes,
you got like
I
to you as well.
Yeah, I bridged the gap well from spiritual to realistic.
Reality.
Yeah.
Which I like.
Yeah.
Because I need people who have more belief in things I'm seeing.
Yes.
I'm very straight in that way.
Which is
times.
Important if you want to create a new reality.
Apparently.
Like they do in tech. If you keep looking at what is, you'll keep getting what is. If you want to create something new, you must be able to believe in the unseen.
And that's why I heard. Cut. Done. So I think it was pretty shortly after that.
Shortly, very shortly, yeah.
That
I think we went for coffee.
Yeah.
And you just said, I need to hire you.
Yeah. Just the way you talked about things and the way you talked about business. And I was in, I started full time as an artist in 2006. So that was 2010. So I was 4 years into full time.
Yeah.
And I was like, full up, I won't say shit show. I would say I was into a lot of things.
Right.
Trying to figure out what I was doing. And
oh, because
there
I remember.
So many options.
Oh, here's. Can I tell the story?
I'm not sure. I don't know what story it is.
So this is a good business lesson, and we've all done it. So I've done, like, everyone's done it, I'm sure. But I'll never forget one of our. Must have been like our third or fourth or fifth meeting, because we had to be at least a few meetings in where I needed enough time to get to know you a little bit, how you work. And then I'll never forget one time. So this is a good lesson. Okay. So this is
why do I feel nervous? Because I don't know what the story is.
So when you look at and you say, this is what I want to create, and then you got to look at how are you spending your time.
Oh, yes, that's a good one.
And then one day I got Kellyanne to map out 3 or 4 months ahead and her schedule. And
which I'd never done.
No, and I was like, okay. So she lays out her schedule. She says, okay, we're doing this, we're doing that. And it was projects such as, like, you had a lot of volunteer projects actually at that time. Volunteer for this, volunteer for that, da 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 da. I'm gonna do this, I wanna finish that, da da da. We're going on vacation here, blah 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 blah. Okay. So I go, okay. Hold on a second. So you're telling me you wanna build your business online, which means you need to do these things, but for the next 4 months, you have this much time to work on the things, to accomplish the thing you say you want. And what this was a big lesson in learning to say no.
That was a big one. I'm really good at it now.
Yeah, she's like almost too good at it. Gets on my nerves
almost.
Sometimes.
The phone. Now she gives me a hard time.
She's epic boundaries. But the but the boundaries were necessary to create the life you really wanted.
It's true.
And I think it's can be scary to become a no person, primarily no, especially when your business isn't where you want it to be, especially when...
And you're grasping.
You're grasping.
Trying to find that right hook.
Trying to find the hook, trying to please people, trying to take whatever you can get. Because in Kellyanne's case, what she was doing was a lot of stuff that was going to get her exposure. But when we looked at the, I think my favorite part of that exercise was, how much time is it going to take for you to go do that thing? And you said, that's what, and I said, really?
Just
is
like
that how much time it really takes? How much time do you prepare for that? And what's the post work on that? And et cetera, et cetera. And then you realize, oh, a 1 day project is actually a 4 to 5 day project.
Yeah. And we're talking like 8 hour a day.
Yeah, like full on. And then you can't, because you're only one person, you only got so much time, right? You only have so much and mental energy. And this is for all the entrepreneurs. You know what? I don't care if you're an entrepreneur or not. If you want something in your life and you're not devoting time to it, or you're devoting things, it's like time to the wrong tasks.
Yeah.
That's why an outside person in your business is so important.
Yes.
Because oftentimes, objective, you don't even realize. You think you're working on the stuff that's going to get you what you want, but in reality, you're not.
No, and that's what I was doing.
That's what you were doing.
I thought I was doing what I should be doing.
Should be doing.
But then Jennifer told me I was not. Which is what I love about Jennifer. She's told me that a few times in my life.
Yeah.
And it's right.
Yes.
Like, you're not telling me anything that's not working to my benefit. Like, you
correct.
Always say the right things that has always sent me in the right direction.
Well, I mean, that's the goal. I mean, I think, well, my role as a friend, but also as a coach or like an advisor,
mm-hmm.
that's the role. It's honesty to get you where you say you want to go. Like,
yeah.
That's what's the point.
And the time appreciation one was the best. So let me just tell you guys the phone call that we were having. So she's like, all right, so you're going to do this painting in public. And I'm like, yeah, no biggie. I'll just get in, get out. Don't mess my hair up. She goes, okay, how much time is that going to take? I'm like, oh, good question. I never thought about it. I was going to do it. So I laid it out. I'm like, okay, if Jennifer's asking, I'm going to do it and do it right and get all the information, and because I don't want to waste my time or your time.
Correct.
So if you're saying something, I'm like, yeah, okay, let's pay attention to it for the time it takes. So I break down how much time it's going to take. So the pre-thought, prepping the canvas, confirming the space, the marketing to actually get people to even look at you while you're there.
Yeah.
Because it's one thing to be painting in public, but
with no one there,
I can stay in my goddamn studio. So it's this and this, and then afterwards, and there's always follow-up, and then you want to, you know, do the publicity afterwards because a project like that deserves all that attention.
Absolutely.
If you're going to do it, might as well do it well, is my theory.
Yeah.
So I tell Jennifer, oh, well, I think actually it's going to take like, I don't know, 45 hours, it turned out to be. Or something crazy.
From a 8 hour.
No biggie.
8 hour project.
Yeah. So I said, yeah, it'll probably take, and I probably maybe trimmed it a little bit and said, oh, maybe 30 hours. And then there was silence. And I'm like, oh, God. And she goes, Kellyanne. And when I hear that, I'm like, uh-oh, JT Smackdown coming in 3, 2, 1. And I'm like, uh-huh. And she goes, how the hell do you expect to get any of those other things done if you're spending all your time doing all these other things? And I'm just like, honestly, I don't know. And it was like one of those like wake up calls that, and then I kind of felt like an idiot. I was like, I know it takes time. It's not like I'm completely stunned, like sometimes. But
I think I did say that to you, didn't
you? And you were just like, you have this list over here where you're doing all these things. And how are you ever going to accomplish what is actually on your list?
Oh my god,
and since then, I am like, every time anyone's like, oh, you want to go out for a drink? I'm like, let me evaluate. It's going to take me half an hour to get there. We're going to do 3 hours of sitting around, and then afterwards, or someone wants to meet you for a, let's just talk about a volunteer event. Like, it's not much of your time, but I think it'd be really beneficial, great marketing for you. How many times have I heard that?
Yeah.
But then when you evaluate the time, and I think that alone, like not only in business, but in life, really.
Oh, 100%.
And then the tone, I was like, oh my God.
The tone. Snap, snap.
Let's like.
I didn't even know I did that. Until you told me. And you're like, I know when it's coming. The tone.
Yeah.
I'm like, am I turning into my mother? Which would be a,
my mother is awesome.
She is
so.
Up. So it wouldn't be a bad way to
no.
But yeah, it's the Kellyanne. And shit. Tell me, Jennifer.
So that's not coaching. That's just like,
well,
get with it.
But that's coaching.
Well, yes, that's true.
And I actually like your approach. And that's why I hired you, because I like your style and I liked your honesty, but it's for the... the betterment.
The greater good.
The greater good. Yeah. Like, you're going to tell me how it is, which is what I need.
Yes.
Like, if you were just like, oh, no, you're just doing a great job. Just make a good list.
And oh, yeah.
You go, oh, I'd be like,
yeah.
Yeah, okay, thanks.
Yeah.
I'm good at lists. Yeah.
You are good at lists.
But you're good at the, I do call it the JT Smackdown.
She does.
And you know it when you hear your name. And, and then she gives it to you. But it's a good give it to you. It's kind yet firm. And I like
what's
that.
Funny is that so many of my clients, if they're watching this, they're like, uh-huh.
Yeah.
And they have said that, but
and
in different
words.
Yes.
Like, what was that? I got this testimonial recently, and I sent it to you, and I'm like, look, she's talking about this without realizing she's talking about it.
It's the JT's next.
Yeah. And something like, Jennifer will tell
and
you
it was
like
kind.
It is, but with kindness,
yep.
I think was the word she used.
And you're not faking the kindness.
Oh, no.
You're so into your clients succeeding that it is infectious.
Yeah.
And it has kept me going. And it actually pulled me out of the bitterness and anger I had about business.
So, can I elaborate on that for a second?
No.
I think that this is good. Okay, now the reason I want to talk about this is this came up. So, I'm in the middle of a group program right now around mindset.
Change your story.
Change your results. And someone brought this up on our first training call, and it was a lot of anger and resentment in the business. So I want to talk about this for all entrepreneurs because
it's a thing.
So I call it the dip.
Oh, the dip.
Yeah, it has a this is what it is. Tell me if you recognize it from this standpoint.
I already do. I'm like, yeah, the dip.
You guys tell us if you recognize this.
Yeah.
Okay, so here's what happens to entrepreneurs. So every entrepreneur starts their business and they're like, oh, I'm gonna change the world and I wanna do this and I wanna do that and I'm going to help people. And so they start. Do, 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 do.
Good intentions. Yeah.
Then, wrapped up with expectations.
Oh.
Expectations.
Yes.
Expectations. Everything's going to be easy and fun. And
money's going to roll in.
And everyone's going to love what I have to say.
Yeah. And I'm just going to pop up into stardom in like 6 months.
Yeah, no problem.
A year maybe.
So 6 months to a year in, you're like... wait a minute. I'm not on schedule.
Yeah, right.
Like,
Where I don't I'm have where's the money?
I'm not on that tight schedule.
And my website's not up yet. And
and I can't afford it.
And I can't afford it. And okay. So Beth, let us know if people are resonating with this. This is really funny. So then what happens is, and here's what's important to know about this. You don't even know you're about to do this. Like, because your intention, because intentions are good. Like, I think all 99.999% of entrepreneurs, like, all of them come into it. Like, they want to help people. They have a gift. Like, they want to spread joy or they want to create a solution. Like, I mean, that's what business is about, right? Yep. Creating solutions. So you're going along, and you're like, this is awesome. But then your expectations are not being met. Your income expectations, this is where the dip happens. And the dip that I'm referring to is an emotional dip, not necessarily a dip in something else. Mm-hmm. Although that can hit the physical manifestations can happen as well, but this is the dip. And so before you even realize it, you become resentful of your business or the people who are engaging with you but not buying from you.
Do anything
about it or whatever. And so what ends up happening is you were so excited and happy about your business, and at some point in time, you probably can't pinpoint it exactly, but you can pinpoint when it started to derail. And because your expectations of results have not been met, you start to go into anger and resentment and bitterness without even realizing it. And then what happens is, when you're in that state, you show up differently in your business, and now your business can't even get the results you're looking for.
You're putting out that.
Because you're not being who you need to be to get the results you want.
That's true.
Which is usually when people call me.
Yeah.
So...
Right.
So this happens to, like, basically almost every entrepreneur I've ever had at least a somewhat in-depth conversation with to figure out their business and how it unfolded. And sometimes when I meet them when they're there, sometimes they've been through it, whatever. But I think that you have to be careful of this dip, because the dip is self-imposed. It is not the people who are not buying from you that the problem is. It is the meanings you're making of what's happening to you that creates the dip.
Yes.
And then if you don't know how to turn that around, you're going to be in there for a long time.
Yes.
So that's the dip.
And the dip is real.
The dip is real.
Yeah. People. I dipped a couple of times in the last 10 years.
Yeah.
It's like I go through sort of ups and downs, like, even still.
Yeah.
Which...
I think they do continue to happen. The question is, how fast can you get out?
Yeah. And it helps to have someone else in your corner. I mean, Besh is awesome. He's so good for, like, helping me talk things out and just having that, like, objective...
Yeah.
Look at it, but then it's also great to have even somebody else, even
further out who's not involved in the day-to-day.
Yes.
That's what matters.
And that's what you've done, is just, you looked at my whole situation, and you're like, okay, and you're so good on the encouragement of the good stuff.
Yeah.
Which, of course, like, if I was looking at someone else's business, I would be encouraging them the good stuff.
Sure.
But I like how much you believed in me. Mm. All this time, like right from the beginning, and you love my artwork, and you got me, but I think you get your clients, and your clients get you no matter what. That's how you guys click, and that's how the spark happens.
So, do you want to know something interesting?
Yes.
I have to tell this story. So, one of the things that I've learned over the years and more recent is that your true gift, which is where you really shine, which if you're an entrepreneur is where you're going to really make a difference and make money, is in the thing that's most innate and natural to you.
Right.
And I think it's combined with where your wound is as well.
What do you mean?
So, well, I'll give you the example and then it'll present itself. Yeah. So 5 years ago, I came home one day and got news that my father had cancer. And what we didn't know that day was how fast that was going to take him out. And it was 11 days from coming home news, 11 days to, and Kelly, I knew my dad, to going to the funeral home.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Extraordinary person.
Awesome businessman.
Yes. So I grew up in an entrepreneur household, and dad was an entrepreneur and a philanthropist. And when he was in the hospital,
I should say, it's Wayne Trask.
Yeah.
For those
lots of people
would know.
Lots of people in Newfoundland would know, yeah. Maybe bits of Canada. But anyways.
Yeah.
So when he was in the hospital, I went into his office one day and went into his warm and fuzzy files. And these files were filled with cards and notes and printed emails and things like that from over the years of people who wanted to say thank you to him and things that us, his children or mom, had given to him over the years that he deemed warm and fuzzy and wanted to keep. And so I was pulling them out and reading them, and I began to notice a trend. And the trend, no matter where it came from, whether it was a colleague or a friend or a family member or a mentee or whatever, the theme was, thank you for believing in me.
Mm.
And now at the time, now hindsight has given me more valuable information because it was also just such a, I mean, with this shocking time when this kind of stuff happens, you're just sort of going with the day to day. But what I realized was, and in hindsight, looking at Dad's parenting and how he showed up in the world for others, and this was something I knew when he was alive, but more deeper reflection and looking at these notes, that was Dad's gift. Dad was always someone who, which I wrote about in his tribute to him, he always saw people for who they really are. Meaning their true potential, not where they were, not who they thought they were, not their faults. And that's what made him a good leader and a great entrepreneur.
Yep.
And what I didn't know was that he had passed that on to me through osmosis, I think, through growing up in the household. And
genetics.
Yeah, through genetics. No, but through practice. And he also believed in us four kids, like, he and mom were our biggest fans, and he, particularly me and my brother, who are both entrepreneurs, he always passed that on. And so I didn't know that that was my best gift until that sort of happened. And then also having many clients like you say that to me. Now, the wound piece is interesting because what I think, it sort of ties in with some of the self-esteem things that came, except from my childhood, it came more from friends, like from being bullied. I had very supportive parents at home, which is very lucky.
Yes.
All I wanted was to be believed in, but from a different angle. Right? From
you
a different angle.
Parents,
I had my parents' belief, but from a different angle of being worthy of different things that I wanted at that time. And so I think that when you bring that into your business, whether you're an artist or a coach, or you own a retail store, or you're an investor, like, it doesn't matter what you
event planner.
Event planner. Because people do business with people. It's people who are running these things. People,
yeah.
People are magnetized by people,
mm-hmm.
you know? So even like if you're a realtor, right? Like, well, what makes you different from all the 10 million other realtors there are in the market that can buy or sell your home?
Yep.
And it's who you're being when you're with people.
Yes.
And who you're being when you're putting yourself out there. And I think that that's a powerful lesson in being able to create your boundaries as well.
Yeah.
and therefore being able to show up in your business in a way that serves you and serves your clients and your tribe.
Yeah, that's true. And you were talking about as well the wound piece.
What's
the wound?
Well, what I realized is, for me, the big one was a lack of confidence in being worthy of all that I wanted, which came from childhood bully. And what people, I think a lot of people need people to believe in them.
Yes.
And I wanted people to believe in me that I was worthy of, okay, in the game. Love and having a partner and all that jazz, which, because your personal life affects your business life drastically, they are not separate.
No, they are together.
They are together.
I tried to separate.
It doesn't work out. And so what I realized was in the belief systems that I had built up as a child of, you know, being too big to be someone's girlfriend or this or that, even if people did believe I was worthy of love, I wasn't receiving it. I was blocking it because of this belief system.
Because you didn't believe you were worthy.
Right, which echoed into my business, which I didn't even know, because I didn't know they were connected until I knew.
Yeah.
And then, and this is why the work, the inner work, the mindset work matters so much, because what we don't realize is when you have wounds in certain areas of your life, they affect other areas of your life, even if you think they're separate. They are not separate.
Yeah.
And
until you sort them out.
Until you
they
sort
will
them
keep
out.
Affecting.
Right. And so your wound is your gift. What I mean by that is, in being able to do the work around healing that worthiness, I was able to believe in myself more, which helped me believe in others more, because you can't give something you don't have.
That's true.
And you have to have it for yourself first. It's the, like, you need to fill your cup thing, right?
Literally.
Oh, literally. Oh, my God, our cups are getting filled.
Oh, it spilleth over. Thank you.
Thank you. So I think that that's really important to understand, because it will make or break your business, because it will make or break you. Like,
yes.
So for example, when I
your business is just an extension of
you. Your business is an extension of you.
Yeah.
What I always think is for entrepreneurs,
it's in the
get the blue ice tray. Yeah. And yeah, I think for entrepreneurs,
it's like a drawer.
let it go. You'll manage it out.
Yeah.
Being able to realize that whether or not you are your brand, you are your brand.
Yeah.
Like whether or not your name is on the label or not, thank you.
It's you. No matter what.
No matter what. And even so, even if you look at a brand as big as Virgin, most people equate Virgin with Richard Branson, even though he has, I don't even know how many companies he has in Virgin, right?
And 1 million employees.
And 1 zillion employees. Like, so he's clearly not running the day-to-day operations in those businesses. But because
it's still an extension of him.
And so people equate that fun, loving, giving,
free spirit
personality that he is with the Virgin brand. And so I think that that's a really important thing to recognize. And which thus means the more conscious you are of who you are and doing the work, the more the real you can show up in your business, and the more you will attract true fans and people who adore you and love you and who get you.
Find your people.
Find your tribe.
Find your tribe.
And what I've found is for most entrepreneurs, they're so wrapped up in trying to be someone who they think they need to be that they're not being true to who they are.
In order to make money.
In order to make money. When in reality, if you look at some of the business moguls of today, or those who inspire us in the arts, or any, or people who come before us, the reality is that they are the out-of-the-box people who allowed themselves to be their wild and wonderful and questionable self, and that's what works, because I think at the core of who everyone is they just want permission to be themselves.
Yes.
But in reality, the only one who can give you permission to be yourself is yourself, and that's why you're attracted to people who are being themselves.
Oh, that's true too.
Yeah. Even if that self is not like you.
Yeah.
But that person,
you're attracted to that spark.
To their authenticity,
yeah,
and their relatability, and that's what really grows a business.
And I think that's why we clicked.
Yeah.
Because you're straight up. It's true. There's no,
no,
there's no back doors.
No.
You don't wonder what Jennifer's thinking. And I love it. And I do. Sometimes the, you know, people who talk around, well, maybe if sort of, kind of, I'm like,
that's the long way.
Yeah.
Let's get to it.
And like I said, you're still kind with it, but
yeah,
but you'll lay it out properly and truthfully,
yeah,
for the greater good.
Yeah.
And talking about the wounds,
yeah,
it reminds me of, like, when I started in the art full time,
yeah,
it was because Besh for years was like, you just gotta do your art. Why don't you just do your art? Why are you working for other people? I'm like, oh my God, because I did my fine arts degree, and I mean, I've heard since the beginning of time, I call it SAS.
Yes.
So it's a syndrome, and it's called starving artist syndrome.
Yep.
And it bites.
Yep.
And I've heard it since the beginning of time, and you know, people just throw it around. They're not even thinking about what they're saying, but because everybody knows it, they're like, oh, you know, oh, starving artist, starving artist, starving artist. So it's all I've ever heard. And then we go to fine arts, and I did my 4 years of fine arts,
yeah,
and I heard it plenty in there, and lots of artists who take a stab at it and don't succeed, and then it feeds the starving artist thing again, and there's all, you always hear the artists who are struggling, and you know, but they love their art so much, they'll just keep doing it, and,
yes,
and I'm like, that is not me.
No.
Like, I love my art, but I don't love it enough to start for it. So when I got into business, going full time, which started in Stayner, Ontario, just north of Toronto here,
mm-hmm,
still in the back of my mind, like I went into it even knowing the starving artist thing, and very predominant in my mind, so I'm like, what the hell am I doing? Like,
yeah,
why do art if this is going to happen?
You're not going to make any money.
Yeah, and if I'm not going to make any money, am I, my, do you want to hear my reason for doing art when I initially started?
Tell me.
This is a good one. To make money. So I have starving artist syndrome, SAS, suffering greatly,
yep,
from it to getting into that business to make money.
Right.
So I started off with a big conflict, which I never understood what that was until I worked with you for years. And
when you had split energy around it, a values
energy
conflict, which creates split energy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I mean,
yeah,
once I learned about it, I was impressed with how far I had gotten with this conflict.
Okay. So do you know what? That's because struggle is celebrated in our society.
Mm-hmm. Especially in the art business.
Especially in business. And in anything in general. Think about it for a second. We often celebrate those who have overcome things.
Yes.
Who have been through great depths.
Yes.
Who have walked
lost.
Right?
And survived.
And survived.
Which is true. That is cool.
Right? It is cool, but it unconsciously teaches us that the only way to be truly worthy of greatness is to have gone deep into the depths.
Mm. That is true.
Which is not true.
Right.
You don't have to struggle to get something. It can be fun and easy.
Right.
And to me, struggle is based on perception. So one of the things I always tell clients is like, your business can be fun and easy.
Mm-hmm.
It will always have challenges, but fun and easy businesses have business owners who view challenges as just another thing.
Yeah.
Whereas people who struggle go emotionally down when a challenge happens.
Yes.
And that's the difference between a struggling artist or a struggling entrepreneur and one who thrives.
Yes. That is true.
It is, mindset is the difference.
And it's hard to crack that shell.
Well, when you've been trained. I mean, yeah. You just said you grew up your whole life thinking it. You went to school and they pounded it into you. Come here, pay us a shit ton of money so you can learn stuff that's going to like take you years to pay back because you're just going to be a starving artist anyways.
That's
what
true.
The hell? Fix that up, schools.
That's true.
Like, no.
And I mean, it's all, yeah. And I mean, we talked about it and other people, oh, you're doing fine arts. Oh. And a BFA, have you heard of that, like Bachelor of Fine Arts? Do you know what they say with a BFA? Bachelor of fucking all. F all. Is that encouraging or
what?
That's
not very encouraging.
And you know what else they say? Mm. What do people with a fine arts degree say after they've graduated?
I don't know.
You want fries with that?
Oh.
Is that encouraging?
Yeah. I mean, unless you want to do that.
No. Which is awesome.
Yeah.
Go for it.
Yeah, if that's what you want to do.
Yeah.
It's about making you happy. But, yeah.
That's a hard thing to... to like go, oh, you know what? I really want to do that.
Yeah.
But it was because of him.
Yeah.
That finally, after we met in 2003.
Wow.
So he was at me.
Yeah.
For 3 years.
3 years.
3 solid years.
Yeah.
And thankfully, really, like I'm only now, honestly, like kind of going, this could have been worth it. Would be like actually working out for me. Only took that long.
Imagine.
Only because it was a hard struggle for me. I mean, it doesn't have to be for everybody. I know some visual artists that are like rocking and rolling. It's like they just did what they knew they had to do and they just were in alignment with everything and
it's the alignment.
Yeah, like it doesn't have to be like it was for me. And everybody has a different journey. And
well, same with me. I mean, business was a struggle with me until I realized it didn't have to be a struggle.
Yeah, right.
And
funny.
Then
that almost sounds so simple. It's
it
silly.
Almost sounds so simple.
Yeah.
But you know, it's like one thing I'll say to clients is, look, if you've been thinking things for 20, 30, 40 years of your life,
yeah,
maybe you should, you know, give yourself a little bit of time to think a different way.
Yeah.
You
it
know,
does
habits,
take time.
Habits are powerful.
Yeah.
And habits can be broken.
Yeah.
But they take intention. It takes practice.
Yeah.
It takes time and focus. But the good thing is when you have a good support system and you know what you need to do, change can be quickly in terms of time on the larger scale for sure.
Yes.
It doesn't have to take a large turnaround, and I think the turnaround begins when you first create awareness anyways.
Yes.
That is the beginning of the change.
Which you did for me.
Right.
And Besh also did for me with his, all that positive talk.
I'm like,
this is bullshit. After a while, I'm like,
this
oh,
is bullshit.
Okay, well, maybe.
Well, one thing... my dad used to say this to me, and I don't think I really knew how valuable this was until I became a coach. But he would always say to me, oh, yeah, now, and how's that working for you?
Yeah, right. Dr. Phil doesn't own that. Your dad did.
And I'm like, how is that working for me?
Yeah.
Oh, yes, that was before Dr. Phil ever came along.
Yeah, right. Dr. Phil watched Wayne Trask and went, good. That's
right.
Line.
And it's true, because if what you're doing or you're thinking or who you're being is not getting you the result, you gotta ask yourself that maybe there's a different way to go about this.
You've asked me that.
Have I?
Yeah.
I'm
over the
surprised.
Years?
Yeah.
Because I mean, the struggle with the art was tough, and I was also going through fine arts. I mean, all we talk about is, you know, it's original paintings, it's like only, if you're doing prints, it's only hand pulled, it's lithographs, it's silk screening. But
right.
When I got into business, I'm like, I don't know, I don't want to just be doing originals. I'd like to do digital
yes.
prints.
Yeah.
And I was interior design industry before that. So I worked with designers and architects who would often order canvas prints. And I was just like, man, that's where it's at. Imagine if I could do canvas prints of my work. But canvas prints are not celebrated in fine arts.
Right.
So I had that another conflict of seeing a different type of art business, but feeling like I was not being a fine artist.
Right.
And I was afraid of what my peers would think.
Right.
And I'm like, oh, they probably think I'm a sellout, and I worried more about that. And Beth was like, you're worried about that? He said, your friends are actually happy that you're one of the few that actually is in the business.
Yeah.
Well, you know, like, obviously we all do, like, different things, like graphic design and and just hearing that over the years. But I really had, like, I had many conflicts in the art. Mm-hmm. So I wasn't being a fine artist in my mind. And I was in it to make money, but I didn't think I could.
Shit, you got a lot going on.
A shit storm of...
And so what happens is, when you think that way, I'm in it to make money, but I don't think I can, you have split energy. And so some days you're going to be on the, I can make money, I can do this. Some days you're going to be on the, this isn't going to work. And so what happens is your actions are never fully in alignment long enough for you to get momentum.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
Right? So,
amen,
sister. Amen. So what happens is when your beliefs are not in alignment, in which Kellyanne just gave us two core beliefs that were not in alignment, the energy is not flowing in one direction. So it's like two streams instead of one strong river. Two streams that are going in different directions, by the way. So you imagine when you're running a business this way, you can see how it's going to create too much conflict.
Yep.
And that's why your results are going to be the result of little streams instead of a strong river.
That's right. Yeah. That is true.
Yes.
And I like the exercise that we did together, which really clarified things for me. Jennifer said, I want you to list your top five values.
Okay.
And I'm like, values? What? What? And she's like, yep. Yeah. Tell me the things that are important to you.
Oh, yes, and I remember your top value, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What is it?
It's fun.
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 Tied with love, I realize.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, you're a
little... Because without love, I'm no fun.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, fun was at the top of my list.
Yep.
And what was it? Fun, family, friends.
Basically, nothing business-wise.
True.
Oh my God. We got a problem here, people.
Houston. Yeah, so when you made me do that list, it really clarified things for me. And I was like, number one, I'm not having fun in my business.
Yeah.
It was a lot of work. Yeah. I was still pulled in many directions and still trying to figure out what I'm doing. And I realized just doing original paintings was too much pressure, and I don't like pressure.
You don't?
Unless it's good pressure, and then good things happen.
Yeah.
But I was all conflicted.
Yep.
But then these exercises as we went along, the values one was really good.
Oh, that's good to know.
And Jennifer's like, you are not having fun in your business, and it's your number one value. And I'm like, wow, that's difficult.
Yeah.
And it's like you're just stating the obvious, but the obvious is not obvious to the one it's happening to.
Never. Never.
Yeah.
Never.
And then after that, I was like, oh, fun. How do you get that in your business? And I mean, we had fun over the years. Like, it was still fun, but it was still so much work because I was working from
the
wrong
dip.
Place. Mm-hmm. I was in the big dip.
You were in the dip.
Yeah.
An expectation and
and I thought, you know, just wanted to be that overnight sensation.
As we all do.
Yeah,
which
only
takes 10 years.
Oh, I heard 18.
Oh, 18. I'd rather the 10.
Me too, but I'm at 18.
But sure.
1990 to 2018.
That's 18, people.
Which is shocking. And it is quite the journey, and it doesn't, like I said, it doesn't have to be so tough.
You know, it doesn't, and I think that that's why it's important to have mentors and coaches and friends who are further along than you.
Yeah.
Because they can slow the learning, or heighten the learning curve, I should say.
Yeah.
But I think the understanding of mindset is that base skill that will make your life, not just your business, but your life easy or your life hard.
Well, and I think that's what you pointed out to me was the fact that you can have a business and a fun life all in one.
Yes.
And I really, and we talked about that just a little while ago, was the separating of business and life.
Mm-hmm.
I was trying to like, okay, I'll just do my business and then I'll live my life.
Mm-hmm.
And then this will just fund this.
Yes.
It's like when you're in business, it is your life, and then the sooner you accept it and love it, it's way better.
Well, even people in jobs, I mean, if you don't love your job, if you go to your job every day and you're like, wow, this sucks, you're not going to come home full of joy and excitement and, right?
Let's just go for a
fight. Yeah, like, no, that energy is going to follow you home, and your partner's going to be like, what is wrong with you?
You're a stick in the mud.
Yeah, or your kids are going to be like, you're no fun. And that's why it all aligns, because you're a whole human being, and we are emotional creatures, and emotions will follow us. You don't get to separate them just because of the category that evokes them.
It's true. And self-employment is an interesting beast because I had a tendency, the tendency to compare myself to working people. Now, when I say working people, obviously.
She means people with jobs.
With like regular
jobs. Yes.
Yeah, right. A structured company.
Structured company, yeah.
And I would always compare myself to them.
Right.
But it's not the same.
It's not.
At
no.
all.
No.
And then I never actually felt like, I kind of felt like, just like, am I kidding myself?
Well, it's funny because I have some friends who have loved their jobs.
Yeah.
Which is great. I mean,
yes, me too.
No matter your vocation, whether you employ yourself or someone else employs you, the goal is to love it because you spend so much time doing it, right? So I'm thinking of this particular friend. She loves her job. Actually, a lot of my friends love their jobs, which is good.
Yeah. Well, you surrounded yourself with people.
I did deliberately. So most of my friends love their jobs. And, you know, I totally lost my train of thought. What were you talking about? I was going to make a good point.
It's about people having jobs, and I compare myself to people with jobs.
Okay, yeah. But, I know what I was going to say. So, this friend was like, you know, I really like it because I can leave it at home and that's it. And I remember thinking, and that, like, that's wicked. That's good for her, right?
A friend with a...
With a job. She has an employer and goes to a job. And
in
when
a company.
When she comes home, she doesn't think about it.
Oh, right. You walk away.
She walks away. She closes the door.
Wow.
Yeah. And I remember thinking, what would that be like?
I don't know.
What would it be like to, like, not think about your work all the time, basically.
I do not know.
And, yeah.
Must be neat.
Yeah, but then I thought, you know, for who I am and what I do and what I want to be in the world and do in the world, I thought, while it's obviously healthy to be able to remove yourself from it sometimes and, you know, go have fun with your friends and family and whatever, I kind of thought, I don't want to close the door at 5 o'clock.
Yeah, right.
You know, because to me, the business is an extension of who I am. And then it's an avenue to communicate it and to share it.
Mm-hmm.
don't turn off. I'm on 24/7. Now, I still have healthy boundaries. Like, you know, for when I'm with friends, I'm with friends, and my phone is not on. And
she still works a lot.
I do. I have
you
good
are
work
committed.
Ethic. I am committed, absolutely. But it's because of how I see it. I don't really see work as work in the same way some people do. And I think that that has gifted me the opportunity to enjoy the flow more. And yet I do have good, I'll do things that are not work related,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah.
That are just fun and what have you. And
whole change pace.
Yeah, because you do have to separate yourself from that. But I guess the point I was trying to make was when people who have jobs who like them because they can close the door at 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock or whatever,
right.
I remember I knew entrepreneurship was for me because I thought, I don't think I want to do that because for me, I've chosen a lot of self-expression through work.
Yes.
Whereas some people, that's not where they get fully expressed. They get expressed in other ways.
Yeah.
But what I realized was that this is a part of who I am and that expression. And I think for artists, that would be huge.
Yes.
Huge.
Because you are full, well,
right.
Expression almost literally.
Right, and so I think artists and entrepreneurs are not that different, really.
Yeah.
They're basically expressing themselves through their art, and for entrepreneurs,
yes.
that is through the business,
yeah.
whatever that is. And so to shut that down because it's a certain time of day is not relevant in
right.
that case.
And then there's the fine line of in self-employment, you can work too hard.
Oh,
right?
Yeah.
Like, and not
yeah.
shut it down.
And that's what Elizabeth is asking about, balance.
Balance.
Oh, what does it say? What does Elizabeth say?
What about balance?
What about balance?
Fine line.
Well, so, as
it's
a good question, Elizabeth, and I think the answer is different for everyone. So,
and it's your own...
Like, for
recipe.
Example, Kellyanne has more personal time than I do. I know that for a fact.
I do.
You do.
Yeah.
But we're at different stages of life in certain areas and are working towards different things.
Yes.
Right? And I think that the balance comes from you have to know who you are and what matters to you and when enough is enough. So,
and that's a I find a learning curve.
Yeah,
like you start off in business and you're like, I'm just gonna work.
Yeah,
get it all set up, and
yeah.
then I'm gonna like go to Fiji and drink martinis. Which you will.
Which you will.
Yes, as long as you have the goal in mind.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, right. You have to find your balance. Like Jennifer does work more than me.
I do.
Yeah.
But for example, this weekend, I took the weekend off.
And came up with us.
With you guys. Now, normally, I work at least one day a weekend, or partial part of that day.
Yeah.
Actually,
I do sometimes, too.
Yeah. And so, I also have clients. They work less than I do.
Yeah.
They have weekend boundaries, especially ones with kids.
Yeah.
And that's it. But like, I think it's a happiness thing. So if you're not happy because you're working too much, you have to do something about that.
Yes.
So I think, and everyone is different. So for example, I talk about this, Gary Vaynerchuk, right? Like, I think he works like 24/7. I don't know. Like,
right.
Well, I think he's working in his sleep. Like,
I
this
think
guy.
You do.
No, I don't know.
I
know. I have better boundaries than that. But I think it makes him happy.
Right.
I don't think, like, based on what I've seen him enough, like, I think he likes being a workaholic, and that's
yes.
who he is.
Is he married?
He's
yes.
married with kids.
Ooh.
But, you know, he's happy. And so, according to him. So, like, right?
That's all there is.
That's all there is. And so I think you have to, I think realistically, you have to decide. And that's why the mindset, because the mindset piece is about knowing who you are. Is about saying, I don't want to work 24/7, so I'm not going to fucking do it.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I don't work 24/7. I don't want to work 24/7 either. Yeah, and I don't.
No, you don't.
I think I have a very good work ethic.
Yeah.
Now, someone...
You know when you have to get shit done.
I know when I have to get shit done, and I know when I need a break.
Yeah.
And as long as I stay true to me...
Yes.
That's all that matters.
Yes.
If someone else thinks I work too much, they're not living my life. Mm-hmm. And vice versa. So I think the question...
And everybody has their own scale.
Everyone has their own scale.
Yeah.
And FYI... to me, it's not about time, it's about intentional time, which, interestingly enough, I'm reading this book called Grit, which I highly recommend. Forget the name of
that.
The author, but if you Google it, you'll find it. So grit is the number one indicator of success in any area of life. So we're talking about entrepreneurship here. So you can, in the book, there's a little test you can take, and you're on the grit scale of 1 to 5, and I'm like 4.7 or 4.8 or something.
Does that mean you're gritty?
It means I'm a very gritty person.
She's gritty.
Which I'm not surprised. Which most entrepreneurs who become successful are very gritty people. Anyways, so grit is about a combination of passion and perseverance. So how passionate are you about the thing? How much perseverance you have in you? Like that willingness to go, no matter what happens, which is so key to entrepreneurship because... Again, it's about managing expectations. But anyways, so in the perseverance bit, one of the things that they've noticed, and they've really studied this in athletes especially, so there's a difference between the amount of time you're in something versus the amount of intentional time. So a really simple example is this. So I'm a runner and I like to run. But I run for me. I don't run for time. I don't run for pace. I don't run for mileage. I run for me. So I might run more than someone else. But if someone else is running with intention and focus, they could become a better runner than me. Because if they're running to get better at their time, to get better at their speed, to get better at hills, whatever, and they're intentionally out running to get better at running, which I am not. I am out to run to feel good, to exercise, to enjoy the sunshine. Like that's it.
Get your blood flowing.
To get my blood flowing, like for mind clarity, that's why I run. I'm not running to beat my time, to go longer. Like I don't care about that stuff.
Yeah.
But someone who does care about it and who measures it will become a better runner faster than me because they're intentionally practicing. So this comes back to when you're working in your business, working with intention and focus, mm-hmm. you'll get more done in, say, 4 hours than someone who's working with distraction for 12.
Which is where I feel I started when I met you.
Right.
I was running with no intention.
Right.
I was just running.
Right.
In fear.
Which I think is where most people are. A lot of people are running
yeah.
their businesses.
And when you start...
You have to.
You
don't know what
you're
doing.
I mean, some people have like extreme direction, and I'm so, you know, enamored with the people. Like we watch like Chef's Table on Netflix,
oh, yeah.
and those chefs, like they something happened to them. Someone made a pastry for them when they were 12,
right?
And they're like, "This is what I'm gonna do the rest of my life." And I'm like, "Oh my God! If I had only known,
yeah.
If I picked up a pencil and went, this is it."
No.
I would have,
right.
But I was just running.
Right, you were running.
Yeah, but I do hear about the people who.
but I think no matter when you have your epiphany of what you start, what I'm talking about is, so Elizabeth had mentioned balance and time and scheduling.
Yeah.
And what I always tell people too is this: it's not a working harder phase. Like, I think
it's hard not to work hard.
It's hard not to work hard.
Hashtag, #1, #hard not to work hard.
But I think it's about focus and commitment. Like, we've all had those times, and this is why alignment and mindset matters, because it's about flow and intention.
Which I didn't know.
Right. So we've all had those days. Like, the average 8-hour worker is not working 8 hours. They're working about 2.5.
Right.
The other 5.5 hours, they're at work. They're talking to people. They're thinking about their love life. They're thinking about what they have for lunch. They're on a smoke break. They're talking to people. They're
coffee.
Doing this. They're doing that. They're on a coffee break. They're at the water cooler. They're gossiping. They're responding. They're doing things. Like, they're not actually on focused work to get them ahead in whatever it is they're doing. And this is, studies have shown this. This is not me, like, making shit up. Like, this is real.
Yeah.
And so, if you think of, like, I think, learning how to not get distracted while you're working and staying focused is one of the most, like, God-sending, saving skills of your life.
That's free.
That's free.
Because you'll pay for a lot in business, but that's free.
Yeah. And
that is true.
It is true.
You actually taught me that, too.
Yeah. So that's where I think the, if you want more, if you want to work less, you've got to learn how to focus.
You gotta work better.
Work better and smarter. And then you need to, like, you know, when start hiring stuff out, because
yes, that's a epic tipping point.
Yeah, that's a tipping point. That's your thing. And that's how you work less but get more done, and how you work less and make more money.
And it's hard to hire people before you know what your intention is and where you're going.
So that's why you gotta get that clear first.
I gotta hire a mindset coach.
Just call me.
And a business coach. Yeah. It's true.
Yeah.
But it's such a, and it sounds complicated maybe in the whole,
it's not.
Now that I look back at it, like when I was in the flurry of all of it.
Yeah.
It seemed like a lot, and I'm like, I'm never gonna get there. Like, this is just too hard, but it's not.
No, now you're doing it.
Yeah. And then walking through the exercises is such a good thing, because you were also good at, like, you know, what I thought my fine arts friends were going to think of me. And you're like, but are you going to be successful in what you're doing? And I'm like, I'd like to think. And you're like, well, that's all that matters. Don't worry about what other people think about you.
Yeah.
You're running your own game. So yeah. Run it and run it good. And
yeah.
Make it yours and make it an extension of your personality. I think I was, I don't know, like, felt like I was fighting a beast.
Yeah.
And now I don't feel like I'm fighting a beast. Now I feel like I'm, like, making my own beast.
Well, you were fighting a beast. You were fighting yourself.
Yeah. And I am tough.
Well, what's interesting is,
I know, it can almost make me cry.
Most people, I don't think, realize they're only fighting themselves. Because, you know, from a young age, most people are told, like, don't do this, don't do that, don't be so loud, don't be so quiet, why can't you do this, why can't you do that,
pick a profession,
just
pick one.
A profession, just that. And it's like, you know, your personality is, like, shut down, and whether it's from parents or siblings or from teachers or from instructors or just from people, and they're probably most of them well-meaning, put them in fleeting comments, and some of them probably well-meaning,
yep.
Some of them not so much,
or just
but the reality is, well-meaning or not, how you receive it and the meaning you attach to it, and therefore decisions you make moving forward, rolling into your life,
yeah.
And then this is the thing, it's your life.
Yeah.
No one else is going to live for it. And you know what's interesting? We care so much about what other people think, but in reality, most people aren't thinking about you as much as you think they're thinking about you. They're just thinking about themselves.
Hashtag.
Right? It's so true.
It's so true.
And
nobody cares that much.
We spend all our time like, oh my God, what are they going to think if I do digital?
Who fucking cares? They don't care about you.
It's true.
Right? And even if they are thinking about you or talking about you, they're thinking about you, talking about you for like 2 minutes, and then they're on to the next thing and whatever.
And no matter what, when someone gives their opinion on what you're doing, it's only from what they're analyzing in their own life. Like,
correct. They don't have
the
full
perspective.
We are
the, like, or that person is the catalyst that brings us something out in somebody. Like, oh, you think you're an artist or blah, 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 blah. Wow. Like, do you do that for a living? Like, you mustn't do it for a living. What's your real job?
Oh, my God. Do you know how many times I was asked that?
Yeah. Right. Oh, you do that for a living? You're a mindset coach?
Yeah.
Like, for real?
Like, for real?
Like, in between
like people
your
pay
job?
For that?
I know.
Yes, and they pay a lot of that.
And so
because it's worth it. And
it is worth it.
And it's all definitely based on perspective. And, you know, it's funny. We live in a world where people will pay, like, $50,000 for a purse. Like, come on, people.
Yeah.
Like, people will pay $50,000 for a purse.
Yeah. You can pay less for...
You can pay less for
direction
art.
In
well,
your life.
Direction in your life or whatever. But, yeah. And I think that this one was a big one for me because I cared a lot. And I especially cared a lot about what the people I cared about thought.
Yeah.
You know? And when sometimes you
And you
want
to make your family proud.
You do.
And you want to...
You do. And
be in alignment with your friends and
yeah.
want to feel successful and
yeah.
like you're making a difference and
absolutely. And I think that but sometimes you have to take a road less traveled, and that's scary.
It's scary.
Yeah,
but it makes for great conversation at parties.
Listen,
I love it when we're at a party. Oh, what do you do for a living? I'm like, oh, I'm an artist. They're like, what? Like, do you make a living at it? It's usually
really?
The first thing I hear.
Wow.
And it always cracks me up. At first, I'm like, I used to get insulted. I'm like, yeah, I do. Almost. Silently in my head.
Silently in your head.
Yeah. But now it kind of, I almost feel like I'm in this, and maybe I was in it for this reason from the beginning, is to prove I thought it was to other people, but to prove to myself
yeah.
that I could actually make a living at this.
Yeah.
But I didn't realize how much I was going to make it my own. I thought I had to follow that one path and do paintings. But I realize it's different than I ever would have thought it was going to be. Because now it's
well now
Newfoundland and
so you've
vlogging
switched to the ship carrying you.
Yeah. Story. I'm on a cruise ship now.
So here's
cruise Kellyanne.
Here's an analogy.
Book now.
And then here's an analogy that for every entrepreneur out there, especially if you're struggling, you'll
this.
Love this. You'll get this. This is a game changing analogy if you can make this shift.
And this is a new one, right? Like this is your
well, it's okay, so I'll tell you how I explain it, and then I heard someone else explain it a different way, and then I thought their way is better, so let's use that from now on. So the analogy that I always use, so I'm going to tell you two analogies. First, the one that I was using. They tie together nicely, actually. So the first one is, and this is because this is when most people come to me. So this is when you hit the dip. So when you start your business, you tend to be running it more from inspiration and abundance, and you believe it will work and all this stuff. Most entrepreneurs will get to the point where they're more in fear and in lack, and they're worried about paying the bills, and can they make this happen, and is this really for them, and are they going to be able to do it, and then they're in the dip. And the goal is to get them back out, right? The goal is to get back into abundance and trusting that this is for you and that you can do it and that you'll be fully supported and all this jazz. So the analogy, the visual analogy that I think really helps with this is if imagine you're swimming in the ocean and you're swimming just to keep your head above water, but you're not just trying to keep your head above water. You've got a chain attached to your ankle, and on the other end of that chain is a boat that's sinking, and that's your business. And so you're trying to keep yourself and your business afloat. You're supporting the business. And that's how most entrepreneurs are running their businesses. Whereas you want to flip it, and your business is like a cruise ship coming over the ocean, and you get on the cruise ship, and the business is supporting you. And when the business supports you, you come from a place of trust and knowing that what you need will come, that whether that's money, that's a support system, that's the next idea, that's the marketing, it doesn't matter what it is, that the business will support you because life supports that which supports life, which I learned many years ago from a coach I had years ago. And I thought, you know, that's really true. We live in a world of expansion, and as more people come onto the planet, everyone's still getting fed, architecture is growing, and expansion in cities and new innovations. And why is your business any different than that? Why is your business the thing that stays stagnant? It's not. It's a choice and it's a mindset. You've got to shift over to realizing if you want your business to expand and you want to expand, you've got to go with that expansion. But with that expansion comes a trust. And trust is the bridge from you being in the sinking boat to you being on the cruise ship. And when you trust in that which is beyond yourself, whether you want to call it universe or God or Buddha, or doesn't matter, but it's that thing that you're not here by accident. No one is here by accident. And everything you have that's within you is here so you can live it and fully breathe it. And if you have dreamed it, you can make it happen, but you can't make it happen if you don't trust in yourself. And the trust in yourself will put you on the cruise ship, which will allow your business to move along beautifully while you get to enjoy the sun and the air and the drinks and the people and all that. And this is the difference between businesses that are fun and easy or businesses that are struggling. And so it's not that when you get on the cruise ship, you don't have challenges. You do. It's how you view them that keeps you on the cruise ship.
That's true.
That's a good analogy. That's a good analogy.
And I only heard that like 2 days ago.
Through text.
What time is it?
Time to go.
Hour and a half.
Oh, it's an hour and a half.
What?
Wow. Time flies.
I was like,
do we have any questions?
Wonder what was up.
Just comments. Yeah. Please.
And I love the cruise ship idea because I feel like, I don't know, I was in the boiler room for a long time. Like,
of the cruise ship.
She
was on the cruise ship.
It's true. I was just below deck, I think.
Yeah, below deck.
And it was like, it was a coal-driven cruise ship that was dirty and I wasn't loving it.
No.
And I mean, it's not great every day.
Yeah.
Like, it's still like, I mean, self-employment, wait a minute. Still, for me, has its ups and downs.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, I can make a shit ton of money 1 month.
Yeah.
And then not a shit ton the next month.
Yeah.
And it's that, like, just staying steady in myself through it.
Yeah. And here's something interesting, right? Whether you're self-employed or you're part of a big corporation, businesses go through ebbs and flows of profits.
True.
But if you don't know that, then you're comparing yourself to what you think is going on and you think there's something wrong with you.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
When in reality,
and I
that's
still compare
right.
myself.
So people who are in, say, seasonal businesses understand this.
Yeah.
Like if you're in tourism,
yes.
there was a season.
Here's your big season.
The numbers are high.
Here's your
prepare for the winter because it's coming. Unless winter is your tourist season.
Yeah, true.
Right? Then it's flipped. So that's a good point to bring up because I think that, and especially when you're trying to grow the business to a certain income, like you want to more look at annual income versus monthly income.
Yes. And it's hard sometimes because month to month.
You need to live.
Things need to happen.
Yeah.
But yeah, it is the overall, which took me years to be okay with.
Yeah.
And, you know, I mean, I still try to find sort of steady streams of income to take the weight off of the highs and the lows.
Sure.
And, you know, people are like, oh, what's your busiest time? I'm like, it could be anything.
Yeah.
You know, I've had $25,000 in a January.
Sure.
In a January.
Yeah.
And then February comes.
Yeah.
Dip.
Yeah.
And then how to be okay with the dip in
no with the dip time. and then
and managing
knowing how to
money,
manage it manage
which
money.
Is what we've talked a lot about lately
and
the sooner you can get your money system managed as unfun as that sounds
it's very freeing.
It's almost like the crux of self-employment I mean
we didn't even talk about money mindset
oh yeah
We'll have to do another live.
Actually, we'll have to do one every day for like the next 10 years to get all the information out. But yeah, managing your money is important.
Managing your money is important.
Yeah. Oh, and I also did hire over the years a money coach.
Yeah.
Because I learned that it was so important and I realized how much it stressed me out.
Yeah. A book recommendation for entrepreneurs, if you have not read this book, read Profit First by Mike McCall.
Oh, yeah, right. You just read that.
Books. I was not saying his name right.
It's the line.
It's Mike. He has a tough last name. I don't know.
Oh, yeah.
Profit First is the book.
Profit First.
Google it.
And there's money coaches.
And there's money coaches.
Karen Collicutt is yours.
Was yours.
Has been my money coach for almost as many years as you've been my mindset coach.
Right, yeah. Yeah, and it's important, and especially because with self-employment, your income changes, and you need to be ready for that.
Yeah.
You know, you need to be ready for that.
And what we learn about, too, is that if you can't manage
$20,000
a year,
yeah.
You're not going to manage $1 million a year.
No. Well, it'll be an even bigger disaster.
Yes.
So you.
It'll just be more stressful.
Stressful, more stressful.
So sort out your money.
Yeah.
And I mean, there's so many. Just Google money management.
Yeah. I would not consider.
Make up your
money expert in that area, but read the book.
Yeah, you are.
Well.
Now you are.
I wouldn't. I would. Profit First does a great job.
Yeah.
Does
read
a
that.
Great job.
Do that.
Read it. Kalowitz? I said his name. Anyways, Google it.
Yeah, you know. So yeah, managing your money is important.
Yeah.
And it is a mindset as well.
It's a mindset. And then when you have the right mindset, you will take the action necessary.
And you'll feel good about it.
You'll feel better. And when you feel good about your money, it just makes a world of difference.
And
like,
the longer you ignore it, the more inner little, just those little like niggles of like,
yeah,
something's not quite right.
Yeah.
Sort out your money. And I know artists are known for, say, not managing their money, which I've always heard over the years. But we manage our money.
Yeah.
And it has helped immensely.
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 Just helps you sleep at night.
Helps you sleep at night.
So as much as it's maybe not the funnest topic on the go right now, but it is essential.
Yeah.
So
Mike Mikalowicz.
Mikalowicz, thank you.
Hey, good
you.
Job, Miss Hey.
Good job, thank you. Fabulous. Yeah.
So do we have any final thoughts we'd like to relay? Like
Gosh, based on the comments and or any questions, what do you think?
We're good, everyone just says thank you.
Oh, okay, good.
That's good. Well, thanks to everybody who's actually tuned in.
Yeah.
That's wicked. I hope it was beneficial. Even just us talking about what we've already talked about over the years, I still feel like I kind of have like extra, like, oh yeah, right. Oh yeah, right.
Right.
Yeah.
And I think that's why it's important to have, one, entrepreneurial friends, two, mentors and coaches. And,
yes.
Because the learning never stops.
No.
Ever.
Yeah.
And I think, too, a lot of these concepts...
Keep your brain sparky and your heart sparky.
And I think these concepts, too, what I've noticed is as you move along, you learn them at deeper levels.
Yeah.
Like you...
They sink in.
They sink in deeper, and...
It's one thing to have it in your brain.
Oh, well, that's a...
And then it gets into your cells, and then you're like, okay, I get it.
Yeah, I akin that, too. If you're a med student... And you graduate a doctor, but until you start practicing what you learn in med school, right? And
you
it would take
really know it
no. And I'm not a doctor, but I would imagine it would take a good solid few years before you felt really comfortable, especially if you're a surgeon or something where you're like going into
like
people,
major.
Right? It would take, and it does, and that's why it takes so long to become a doctor, right, or a surgeon or whatever, because it takes literally years before it becomes this sort of unconscious conscience. Competence that you have within yourself, and so you know, give yourself
some
grace.
And so you learn about
yourself,
Like as fruity as it sounds, but
yeah.
It is like self-employment is about getting to know yourself.
It really is, and that's the beauty of entrepreneurship. It gives you that gift. It forces you because if you don't do it, you won't be successful at it.
It's true.
It's too hard.
And until you dig deep,
yeah.
you don't know what you're all about, and you won't flourish until you probably accept what you are.
Yeah.
Figure out what you are, and then accept it.
And then
go in that
shine
direction.
It out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Let it out.
That's true.
Yeah.
I think that's a good place to end.
Ooh. Devil.
Big.
This is a good place to end.
Yeah.
Oh,
look at that. And
look, I have like one little drop to toast with.
Oh, toast to us, to you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Besh.
Well, that was awesome. Oh my gosh.
Yep.
All right.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, everybody.
We had time.
Hope it was helpful. And
yes.
If you have any questions, you can message Jennifer. Just go to her Facebook page. It's up in the post at the top of this live, chummy. So just go to her page, message her.
Message me.
Hire her. She's worth it. Like,
yeah.
I can't even tell you.
Oh, lots of hearts.
Lots of hearts.
Thank you, everybody. We love hearts.
Yeah. And self-employment.
Listen,
it all matters about.
Worth it.
It is worth it.
When it's for you, it's worth it.
Yeah. And you just got to figure it out and ride through it. And do the work that's necessary. And if you can't do it, then find somebody who can help you dig deeper and sort out your shit and get at it. Because time's valuable.
Time is valuable.
And you can't spend all your time sending emails.
And you know what? There's no one on the planet who can do what you do. And you're not here by accident, so you've got to get your shit together and do it, because the people who need you. They don't need someone like you. They don't need Oprah. They need you.
They need you.
And only you can do you.
Yeah. That's true.
Only you can do you.
Yeah. And then let your freak fly. Because your freak is good.
Amen.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks, everybody.
Bye.
Bye.
Good luck.
Good luck.